All right, let's now take a look at some code examples. So I prepared multiple notebooks. One is a multilayer perceptron from scratch implementation just to practice my calculus skills. One is a PyTorch, sigmoid, and mean squared error implementation that I showed you on the slides. And this one is the PyTorch with a PyTorch implementation with a softmax activation and the cross entropy loss. I will only walk you through this one because they are all fundamentally very similar, and yeah, I don't want to make the lectures too long. So let's get started. So here again, just the boilerplate stuff, all the imports. Here are some hyperparameter settings. I set the batch size to 100. It's kind of arbitrary. Usually people like to use also values like powers of 2, like 32, 64, 128. I use 100 epochs. And yeah, here the MNIST dataset. So the MNIST dataset is, or how we load it, is how we did it also in the softmax lecture. So there's nothing new here. I will have a separate video explaining how you can set up these data loaders for your own dataset. So now here we are just regarding it as the standard MNIST dataset that is already included in Torch Vision. So what I want to focus on is really here the multi-layer perceptron implementation. So here, really what's new compared to softmax regression is that we have this hidden layer. So if I remove this hidden layer for a second and just write num features here, then this is the same as the softmax regression code. The only maybe small difference that you might notice is that, okay, I would also have to remove this one, cancel this out. So the only difference is that I'm using small random weights. I asked you why we don't implement, or why we don't initialize the weights to zeros in multilayer perceptrons. So that's something for you to think about. But yeah, here we use a standard normal distribution and we scale it. So the mean, so there are two parameters for this, the mean and the standard deviation. So usually a standard normal distribution, as you might know, has mean zero and unit variance, so standard deviation of one. Here we use a smaller value, 0.1, just making the distribution a little bit narrower, closer to zero. So that's because we don't want to have too large or too extreme values, because recall sigmoid activations can saturate. So then we have very small gradients. So it's actually good to have them not too big. So yeah, that is what we do here. The whole point really is just having small random weights centered at zero. Later, in later lectures, we will also learn about other ways to initialize the weights. But yeah, let me undo that, otherwise the code won't work. So now what's different from softmax is really that we have this hidden layer here in between, right, between the input and output layer. All right, so, but there's nothing really new. I mean, I wish I could tell you something exciting here, but actually it's very similar to softmax, so it's actually maybe a good sign. It's not too complicated, I hope. Yeah, just see, I use Probus here. You don't have to do that, so you can actually skip this step. You don't need that, because if you use the cross entropy loss, PyTorch will already compute that softmax implicitly automatically. Yeah, and when we initialize here the multilayer perceptron, the number of input features is 28 by 28. That's the dimension of MNIST. And I use a hidden layer with 100 units. That's a hyperparameter. You can change that number and see whether it performs better or worse. Yeah, we use also the stochastic gradient descent optimizer. Notice now, so this is, so I have a separate function for computing the loss, that's for each epoch. So how I implement that is I'm iterating over the data loader and compute the loss and add it up. So this is instead of computing it on the whole data set, because the data set might be too large to load it into memory. So in MNIST, for MNIST it might work, but it's just a good practice to implement a function that does it also incrementally. Notice this is just a compute loss function that I use to compute the loss on the training set. This is not the training function. But there was a good question on Piazza. I used something similar before. NoGrad, I before used the manual version, like enable gradient faults. This is the same thing. So here I disable the gradient, or I'm saying we don't need a gradient, so I'm saying don't build this computation graph. Why do I not have to have a computation graph? So here I'm just computing the loss, so there is no backward, so it would be wasteful. Actually, this should be just net, it would be better. Okay. Yeah, and also how I'm computing the loss is, actually I can show it to you also here. So here, how I'm computing the loss is I'm using the negative log likelihood loss, and then I'm calling log probus. This is how we do it, let's say theoretically, mathematically. And I've done that in my from scratch and the other implementation. But in practice, it's actually better to use F cross entropy, the functional cross entropy version. So actually, let me modify this code to show you the recommended way. I did that just for comparison purposes, but it's actually better to have it like this. Hope I don't delete it in a way that it doesn't work afterwards, but we will see, will be a surprise. Okay, so here, yeah, call it cost. All right, so yeah, we don't need to call softmax ourselves because yeah, PyTorch is already doing it for us. But except that the training is exactly the same. We call forward here, so that gives us the outputs, the logits. Compute the cross entropy, where this one does the log softmax for us. Then we set the gradients from the previous round to zero, call backwards to do the backpropagation. And this is just for logging purposes. Maybe I should put it down here. It's like just for keeping track so we can make the plot. And this is the model update. And here I'm computing the loss over the whole training set. This is just for plotting. So this is using this function here. I will actually show you another video after that where I refactor this a little bit into Python scripts. All right. Common problem. I forgot to execute these things. Okay, it's training. So this is training on the CPU. I compiled PyTorch for the M1 Mac, so it might be a little bit faster than on a normal CPU. But yeah, it's still simple enough to just run it on a CPU. You don't need a GPU for that, really. All right, it might take a while now. You have seen the results on the slides already, right? So the loss and things like that. So let me pause this video. I can show you the result in the beginning of the next video. And I will show you also how I would personally run code in Python scripts. So using Jupyter Notebook is super nice for teaching because we have everything in one notebook. But like I said, if our code becomes more complicated, it might be nice to put some of the code into Python scripts where it's sometimes easier to debug. And also you can then reuse some of your functions. So let me pause this video. I will make another video showing you the Python scripts.